Thank you. I would like to welcome everybody to this evening's event and say a few words to introduce what's going to be going on. First of all, my name is Edith Rangelhoff. I'm from the Grüne Bildungswerkstatt. And together with other organizations, we made this evening possible and invited Vandava Shiva to talk to us. Eva Lachowitz, who is somewhere, she's going to say a few words about the other organization, especially WIDE, of which she is a member. And then we will continue.
I'm really overwhelmed. Audience, but of course I'm not really surprised when Vandana Shiva comes. I'm especially happy to welcome Vandana. I know Vandana. I've known Vandana for more than 30 years now.
1987.
Right. And I know how to appreciate her work, her international work, and her work for people, for all people, and against big transnational concerns, and for justice, food sovereignty. So in the name of WIDE, Boston Network, and also I welcome you all very much. I'm very happy to see you all, and I wish you an interesting evening. Thank you.
Thank you, Eva. I would like to briefly just apologize. We couldn't find a larger space for this event on such short notice. So I hope you'll bear with us with the type. But I'm also very happy and very pleased that so many of you have come. The other organizations that I would like to thank, just to make sure we don't forget anybody, is Frauen Solidarität, Brot für die Welt, and the Katholische Frauenbewegung, who is giving us this space. They're not here today, but they gave us this room to use. And of course, the Women's Organization of the Green Party. Then another important thank you is that Vandana Shiva was invited by the organizers of the event Elevate in Graz, which is about music, discussion, and activism, where she will be speaking about civil society activism. So as you've already noticed, the discussion and the presentation is going to be in English. But when we have the questions, you can ask your question if you feel more comfortable in German, and I will translate the question. But the answers will be in English. So I hope that's okay. Yes, preparing for this, I made a few notes to introduce Dr. Vandana Shiva. And I just want to read a few because there is so much that she has done and she has been so active that it's really amazing and very inspiring to read about everything that she has initiated and has been involved in. First of all, she's an environmental activist, an expert on biodiversity. She organizes international campaigns against genetically modified crops and foods. Seed freedom is a big issue against patents on life forms, but I'm sure she's going to tell us more about all of this herself then. And also more a little bit about her background. Just a few organizations that are that she founded. Very important, the Research Foundation for Science, Technology, and Ecology in Dehradun, 1982. In 1991, the organization Navdanya, which is a national movement to protect diversity and the integrity of living resources, especially native seed in India. And she also initiated Via Vidyapith, an international college for sustainable living. She is also on the steering committee of the Indian People's Campaign against the WTO, and she is on the National Board of Organic Standards of India. She advises governments and on sustainable agriculture, and is currently also advising specifically the government of Bhutan, with the aim of making Bhutan 100% organic. And I'm sure you can tell us more of your other advisory. I want to mention three titles of three books, because there is a lot of books. Soil, Not Oil, which is about the relationship between industrial agriculture and climate change. Making Peace with the Earth. It's the newer one, about wrong assumptions of corporate globalization, of limitless growth, and the war against natural resources, and ecofeminism, together with Maria Mies, on movements and philosophies between that link feminism and ecology. So you can see that she's really an active person. I started out with a couple of two questions. One is to tell us a bit about yourself and how you started out on this remarkable life as an activist. The beginning, the Green Revolution, the critique of it, that's what, and then also I have here one quote from your book, Soil Not Oil. Nature shrinks as capital grows. The growth of the market cannot solve the very crisis it creates. And maybe you would like to say a few words about this.
Sure. So, yeah, let me begin with my life's journey. And Eva mentioned that we met in 1987. And Eva won't realize this, but in fact, the conference she had organized, which was called The Laws of Life, on the implications of the emerging biotechnologies. We are talking 87. There was no commercial GMO in the world. And this meeting was organized in a first a quiet place in Beaujave in France, and then it moved to Geneva. And Eva had done all the thinking and research and background. And this is where the corporations had come, as well as some UN people and some independent scientists and activists. And there were three things that the corporation said at this meeting that made me dedicate my life to seed freedom. Start Navdanya, and everything else I've done since then. The first thing the corporation said was, we're not big enough. We've to become bigger. And by the turn of the century, we'll be only five. And you might have noticed there was an attempt by Monsanto to buy up Syngenta, which failed recently, which meant it would have become four, and then two, and then one. The second thing they said was, we are not making enough money selling chemicals. Now, these chemical companies were the same companies that had made chemicals for warfare. And I might mention a little more about that with my critique of the Green Revolution. And they were saying they weren't making enough money. So they wanted to make more money. And they were very honest, because it was a very cozy meeting. It was not adversarial. They were honestly sharing their strategies and visions for the future. So they said, now that there are the tools of recombinant DNA which can move genes across species, which was the subject of our discussion, we can now make genetically engineered organisms. There wasn't a commercial entity, but they were already working on the BT, the Bacillus thuringiensis. And they said, through this, we can take patents. And it was the component in Geneva where it came out that they were already working on the free trade agreement, at that time called the General Agreement on Trade and Tariffs, which became the WTO. And I was working very closely after that with our ambassador to GATT, who was objecting to these intellectual property agreements. And that's how together, Dr. Shukla and I and others created this people's campaign against WTO. Its chair was a former prime minister of India. So it is not the case that governments across the board want to hand over our lives to corporations. So how did I end up being at that meeting? You know, my own background is, my training was physics. I then chose to do a thesis on the foundations of quantum theory because I really wanted to, you know, go beyond the mechanistic thought, because I really find mechanical thought as a big part of the problem. It first defines nature as dead and therefore creates limitless exploitation of nature. But in the process, it has to define women's knowledge as not knowledge. And in my earlier book, Staying Alive, I tracked how the witch hunts were really about annihilating women who knew, who were the healers, who were the ones who took care of society. They were the ones who were targeted as witches. So taking away women's knowledge, creativity, productivity, and denying nature's creativity was very, very much the way that mechanical thought was going, and I wanted to go beyond it. But before I left for my PhD, for which I went to Canada, I wanted to visit my favorite spots. I had grown up in the Himalaya. I walked with my dad, who was a forest officer. And I said, before I go, let me just carry my fondest memories with me. So I went to this place, which used to be a beautiful oak forest. The oak forest was gone. I went to swim in my favorite stream. The stream was dead. And I was so concerned, and I'm talking in this little tea shop. In India, we have a lot of dhabas, you know, these little roadside tea shops, and they make real tea. Yeah? And I was talking about the destruction, and this old man said, yes, but now Chipko has started. Chipko means to hug, to embrace. And this was a spontaneous movement started by women in a very remote village called Reni, who said to the loggers, you can't cut these forests, because they understood how logging was leading to landslides, how logging was leading to drying up of springs, how logging was leading to flooding. And women could connect to all of this. So I took a commitment that every vacation, I will come back and volunteer with this movement, which is what I did. Till we stopped the logging in 1981. Every holiday, I would be there in the villages, walking, village to village, documenting for the women. They knew what they were fighting for, but none of them knew how to read and write. And one thing I realized in that period was there are two kinds of illegitimate knowledge powers in society. Illegitimate in the sense they treat others as not knowing. The first is, if you know English, you're supposed to know more. Which is not true, because every language embodies knowledge. And it's because of this arrogance we have destroyed so many knowledges. The Eskimos have hundreds of names for a snowflake. In the desert of Rajasthan, they have hundreds of names for the snowdrop, for the raindrop. That is knowledge. To know which raindrop, with which size, in which season, with which velocity, will do what to your soil and to your crop. You've already got an ecological narrative in that. I had gone to English schools, so I could write English. I said to the women, I said, this is something I can help with. I can write, put down what you're saying in an English report. And then there's one more. That came with the whole Cartesian method, which said only that which can be measured is the true reality, res extensa. And so out of it came all the quantitative analysis, the ability to make graphs. I said, I know how to make graphs. I know how to speak and write English. This will be my service to Chipko. So I started to write reports for them. And of course, I'd write what they say, but then I'd go to libraries and research the rest. And we eventually managed to get a logging ban because we could do calculations that showed that what the government was earning through royalties from timber mining were nothing compared to what the government was spending on flood relief, on drought, on landslides. And all of this really peaked 2 years ago with the climate issue joining up. 2 years ago in our region, because of this rabid building of dams, we stopped the logging, but they continue to build dams. They continue to make mass tourism out of our pilgrim centers. When the extreme rain came on 16th and 17th of June 2013, more than 20,000 people in my region were washed away with that climate disaster. Didn't make it to any international news. But it is, in our region, the worst disaster we've seen. And because I'd been taught so much by the women of Chipko about biodiversity, when violence erupted in Punjab in 1984, and that same December, we had the tragedy of Bhopal, where a pesticide plant leaked. The pesticide plant was owned then by Union Carbide, which is now owned by Dow. 3,000 people were killed immediately, and thousands since then, and hundreds of thousands maimed for life. And my sister, Dr. Meera Shiva, who also Eva knows, of course, immediately went for medical relief. And one of the things that she was shocked about was when the doctors and the government were asking Carbide, tell us what gas leaked so we can find the antidote. Carbide headquarters said, we can't tell you, it's a trade secret. They let people die for the trade secret. So I decided to look at why was agriculture so violent and wrote a book called The Violence of the Green Revolution, which is how I ended up being invited to that biotechnology meeting. Because I had one book on agriculture. And what I learned through the Green Revolution was, first, it is not true that chemical industrial monocultures produce more food. Actually, they're very impoverished systems. In terms of biology, they're very impoverished. In terms of nutrition, they're very impoverished. They reduce our food availability by half because they displace the crops that women use. I've done assessments. In an ordinary farm, women will have 250 species. All of them give you nutrition. When that goes, you lose your sources of vitamin A. You lose your sources of iron. And you get anemia. You get vitamin A deficiencies. And because I had training in science, I could apply it to my assessments of the Green Revolution. I could start counting how much more water is used, 10 times more water, to produce the same amount of food. When I went to Punjab to understand why there was violence, it turned out it was farmers' protests, labeled in the media afterwards as a religious issue. Exactly what they are doing now. The GMO cotton is failing in Punjab right now. Farmers were on the railway tracks, blocking the traffic. 80% failure of the crop. About 10 days ago, suddenly they find burnt pages of the sacred text of the Sikhs, and then it's suddenly about religion. All the coverage is religion, religion, religion. It was a farmers' protest. 1984 was a farmers' protest. And why were farmers mad? Because they were losing their soil, they were losing their water, they were getting into debt. They were supposed to have got more money out of all of this, and all they were getting was debt. Now, they even have a cancer train from Punjab because of all of those pesticides. So it's not true that chemicals feed the world. It's not true today that GMOs feed the world. As we said in our campaign that we launched on 8th of March this year on Women's Day, women and biodiversity feed the world, not corporations and GMOs. And you know, my critique of the Green Revolution in a way is extended to industrial agriculture using GMO seeds. The system is the same industrial system. It's still a monoculture. It is still energy intensive. It's still based on fossil fuels. It's just that the seed itself is now a seed that's genetically engineered and intellectual property. And that adds a whole new dimension to it. And I don't know, maybe later you have a question on the farmers' crisis, do you?
Yes,
or?
I have.
So I'll hold
about
it.
The small farms versus genetic engineering.
Sure. So we hold it for
and
that.
And then the women. Oh, but you can go.
Okay.
You can continue. Yes.
Okay. I mean, and you know, this quotation that you cited: "Nature shrinks as capital grows." I've watched it again and again and again. I told you about CHIPCO. How did capital grow? By chopping the forests and selling the timber. Capital grew, but nature shrunk. Nature's ability to stabilize ecosystems shrunk. Women's economy shrunk. Women who were bringing food, fodder, fuel had less because the forest was depleted. I did a major study for our Ministry of Environment on mining. And in those days, mining was the biggest source of elections for our region. And everyone said, without mining, there's no economy. We did the assessment. We were losing a natural aquifer that was offered by limestone as the mines took down this aquifer. So they were only seeing the mineral. They were not seeing the water holding capacity. That's what the women were seeing because they were losing their springs. And I've worked out in my 40 years and more of this work, the limit is a 10-mile walk by women for water. They'll tolerate, and then when it's 10 miles of water, they say no more flogging, no more aquaculture. No more Coca-Cola in Plachimada. They shut the plant down. Women of India shut down Coca-Cola in Plachimada in Kerala. Because Coca-Cola, I mean, a bottle of Coca-Cola water is sold for 12 rupees. How did that 12 rupees of profits come to Coca-Cola? They say manufactured by, they don't manufacture water. They just mine it. They go into a village, set up deep tube wells, suck out the water. And because of the processes they use, they leave a lot of pollution behind. 1.5 million liters per day per plant of Coca-Cola. They take it for free. They're literally stealing, which is what the women of Plachimada said. The water level went down, women were walking 10 miles. Water disappeared, agriculture disappeared. Women's time was spent only in collecting water. And then my lama said no more. And they started a satyagraha fight, sitting opposite the gate of Coca-Cola. And they called me and said, come and celebrate Earth Day with us. I think it must have been 2002. And I said, this is very strange. One village, I don't know. Fighting Coca-Cola, why? I don't know. I don't like that drink. It looks toxic to me. But why would women be fighting? So I went to figure out. 100 women, 500 policemen. I said to them, I'll be there till you shut this plant down. And I did everything I could. Yeah. What I've learned over the years is there's no one issue. All issues are important. There's no one way of dealing with the issue. All ways are important. Art is important, science is important, getting your local politicians involved. So Coca-Cola was spending on all the newspapers and all the media. No one would cover this because they gave advertising money. I called up a person who was from a party which had the local government, and he owned a big newspaper, and I rang him up. I said, aren't you ashamed of yourself, giving absolutely no coverage to this movement? And I will come back in so many weeks, and I want you to be there, personally. And I want you to cover this. Once one newspaper broke this censorship, all newspapers had to cover it. He lost 60 million. No, six crores? He lost 60 million rupees in advertising by covering this issue. He came out and did it, and we shut down the coke plant. So no matter where you look, all growth, which is a measurement of the growth of capital, is the conversion of nature into cash and the conversion of women's work and the work for sustenance into commodities. And the measure of growth, which is GDP, comes from the war. Just like the chemicals that are used in agriculture come from the war, the measure of growth as the ultimate measure of capitalist patriarchy comes from the war. During the war, they had to mobilize resources to buy more tanks, more fighter jets, and bigger armies. So they defined and said, if you produce what you consume, you are not producing. That's how national accounts were created. So women working in the home or peasants working in a field were not producing. It's only when you grew something that could be sold and then you bought what you needed, that commodification then mobilized the resources out of which you could buy more weapons. This became the basis of GDP. This is where Bhutan turned around and said, we are not going to measure gross national product and gross domestic product. We are going to focus on the health and well-being of our people. We will create a new indicator called gross national product. And then the Prime Minister wrote to me and said, I can't see us growing happiness in any other way but growing organic. So can you help us? So we help them. Our team goes there, they come to us, and it's a process that's very sustainable. We're doing it. And Bhutan is quite an example to study in terms of breaking out. And if there's one country in Europe that has similar situations, it's you. You're mountainous. Mountains are a wonderful block to keep the rubbish out. It's just more tedious to climb a mountain than go on a highway. You know, mountains are our protectors. And I know one of the strongest movements for seed saving, for organic farming, for local food is in Austria. And it's because you already have that. So I think the women's groups that are here today should all join up to say we are going to create new indicators for an economy that ensures the well-being of nature, the last woman, and the last child.
Thank you. Thank you for the very inspiring talk and also for the ideas. I'm sure it's going to be taken up. When we have new indicators, then we'll announce it. What I also looked at, which I would like to ask you, is also about the relationship between the climate change, the destruction, and the specific effects on women and the industrial agriculture. And then I also wanted to ask you about, there's this new Global Alliance for Climate Smart Agriculture. This is something new that was announced in the media by the American government. Your opinion on that?
Okay. So, about 10 years ago, climate extremes started to become more frequent. And, through Navdani and the movement I started for seed saving, we had saved every seed we could find. We weren't saying, oh, this is useful. We weren't saying this is high yielding. We were just saying, if our ancestors used the seed, it can't be useless. So among the seeds we had saved were salt tolerant seeds that farmers had evolved in the coastal areas. And in 1999, a terrible cyclone hit. twice the velocity of normal cyclones, so it went much further inland and caused more damage. We were able to distribute these seeds. Because with the cyclone, salt from the sea comes on the land. So you need salt tolerance, otherwise you can't grow a crop. And then after, and this was 1999, in 2004 we had the tsunami. And I went to help, and the government of Tamil Nadu says we can't do agriculture for 5 years. They called it a crop holiday. I said, you call it a crop holiday, the farmers will starve. And we'll bring you salt tolerance seeds. Oh, can't be, they don't exist. I said, they jolly well do, they used to be here, you wipe them out, we'll bring from Orissa. Orissa farmers gifted 2 truckloads of salt tolerance seeds. Immediately, agriculture bounced back. So the idea that corporations are bringing us climate smart solutions is very, very misleading. Now, because of our work on seeds and biodiversity, as well as our organic work, where we were actually doing assessments, how much more organic matter is in the soil when you do organic farming? How much more water is in the soil when you return organic matter to the soil? So we've been doing these very, very scientific studies too. And I said, agriculture is so hugely impacted by climate change, but the discussion isn't even there. And let me do an assessment of how much does the contribution of industrial globalized agriculture make to damaging the climate. When I say industrialized, I mean inputs that come from fossil fuels, fertilizer that comes from natural gas, the same factories that originally made explosives. Even pesticides begin with fossil fuels. All of the chemicals in agriculture have their origins in fossil fuels. How much does this take? What happens when the soil loses its organic matter? How much is that contributing? That's when I started writing Soil Not Oil, my book. But I also was chairing the Commission on the Future of Food for the region of Tuscany, and we did a manifesto for Copenhagen. And we put the sums together. It's not that it wasn't there, it was just hidden in the IPCC reports, which is the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change. So you had deforestation figures. But most deforestation today is happening to expand soya in the Amazon, palm oil in Indonesia. In fact, Obama is going to Indonesia to basically tell Indonesia to stop chopping down their rainforest for palm oil. But the problem is all the international companies that create this false demand for palm oil. So deforestation is destroying every year 13 million hectares for agriculture commodities. The concentrated animal farm operations, which are these factory farms, and the only reason they exist is there's such huge subsidies in it. That's why people put all their animals in factory farms. And then there are European standards. When you had the annexation of the East European countries, you know, people there had cows like us, you know, 2 cows per family, 1 goat per family. And they said, no, this is not safe. Milking with your hands is not safe. You've got to have 500 cows and torture them with animal feed, soya bean. So the CAFOs are 11 to 15% responsible. Transportation, shipping food, thousands of miles, 5 to 6%. And when you ship food thousands of miles, and you also increase processing and packaging, about 70% of the waste and garbage is food packaging. That accounts for 8 to 10% of the greenhouse gases. When you ship fresh vegetables miles and miles, you have to have a lot of refrigeration. That's 4%. And half of the industrial food is thrown away, either at the farm level or at the best before date in the big supermarkets. That's another 4%. You add it all up, it's between 40 to 50% of all greenhouse gases the three primary ones being carbon dioxide directly from fossil fuels, nitrogen oxide, which is coming from the use of synthetic nitrogen fertilizers, and is 300 times more damaging to the environment, and methane, which comes both from factory farms as well as for food, from food waste. We are talking about the biggest contribution to climate change coming from an industrial model of agriculture. We also know what's the solution. We know if we have more biodiversity, you protect the soil more, you protect water more, you have more resilience. We know that if we increase organic matter in soil by 2 tons per hectare, which is very easy, our own farm has, you know, in 15 years has got 2.2 tons per hectare. With 2 tons per hectare on all farmland in the world, if the world went organic, we could pull out that excess carbon dioxide that's sitting in the atmosphere, 400 parts per million, and damaging the climate. So not only do we get rid of emissions, we get rid of the stocks, the past emissions, 10 gigatons. In 5 to 10 years, we could get rid of all the excess buildup of pollution in the atmosphere. We also know that when soil has more organic matter, it holds water better. If you have a drought, you won't have a crop failure. You have a flood, the soil will absorb it better and your crops won't die. 0.5% increase in organic matter, 80,000 liters of water holding capacity in soil. So these are the true answers. And in fact, in Paris, when the COP21 will happen, this is the focus of my work. I'm planting gardens when I go to Paris. So say, you know, a garden might look small, but millions of people planting gardens is a big change. After the meeting Eva had organized, I was shaken. These corporations wanting to control life on Earth. I said, how do you deal with them? And what do we do? And on the way back, I'm thinking of our freedom movement. I'm thinking of Gandhi, who took on the British Empire. And how did he take on the British Empire? He pulled out a spinning wheel. He said, if they control us through the textile industry, we've got to make our own cloth. And when he was laughed at and said, how do you think a small spinning wheel will get you freedom? He said, it's the only thing that has the power to take down the empire, because this little spinning wheel can be in the hands of the poorest woman in the poorest hut. So the last person can be engaged in freedom. And so my mind was working, so what's the spinning wheel of today? Now that Eva has thrown my mind in this terrible churl, what is the spinning wheel of today? And by the time I got off my flight at home, I said, the seed. The seed is today's spinning wheel. The rest of my life, I'm going to save seeds. So at one level, one day I will write in one, if I'd ever do a biography, Eva, that at one level, it's your work for that meeting on laws of life that made me realize how important the seed is. It's small. But in the hands of every farmer, it's powerful. A garden everywhere. On your terrace, in your backyard, in the school, in the church. And maybe this is a second idea you can take back, since we are sitting in a Catholic space. And now they have a pope that has written Laudato Si, the new encyclical. Now is the time to put the care for the earth as the central issue, and care for the earth begins with a garden. Now, what is climate smart agriculture? Basically, the language of climate smart began with Monsanto, in a Bangkok meeting. And they've, you know, they've lied for 100 years. They can't get out of the habit of lying. So they started to say, use of Roundup will keep organic matter in the soil. And they have this false thesis that somehow carbon in the soil is escaping all the time. And now there's carbon dating. Carbon in the soil has been around for thousands of years. Doesn't escape, just like that. So if you spray Roundup instead of tillage, we are going to have the solution. So they started to offer use of Roundup, glyphosate, which is now proven to be a carcinogen, as a climate smart solution. It was pushed back. So then they did, of course, what they like are smart at doing. They got other companies together. Now the fertilizer industry, which is such a big cause of climate change, is leading climate smart agriculture. The fertilizer industry, which should not exist, because soil has all the capacity, if we give it organic matter, to make fertility through the billions and billions of organisms that are constantly turning organic matter into nutrition. Creating more nitrogen. Earthworms eat a leaf and create more nitrogen in their mold. Create more phosphate, create more calcium. These are amplifiers. They are the true fertilizer factories that actually build our soil fertility. The three aspects of climate smart agriculture, and it's not a surprise that USAID and others are pushing it. The first is, as I said, more use of chemicals, more use of fertilizer, more use of Roundup. Second, owning more of the climate resilient seeds that farmers have evolved through patents. We have a report of Navdanya called The Biopiracy of Climate Resilient Seeds. 1,500 patents in the hands of the Monsantos and the Syngentas. Do they make climate resilient seeds? No, because it's a complex trait. They steal the varieties. Just yesterday, Mr. Gates, who's a very big piece of this, Bill Gates works very closely with Monsanto. Bill Gates has said, all the money for climate fund should go for improved seeds. And for them, improved seeds means in their hands. When it moves in corporate hands, it becomes improved magically. It's basically pirated seed. And I've challenged the Gates Foundation in debates, where they come out, oh, we've got drought tolerant, oh, we've got salt tolerant. I said, can you tell me where the original seed came from? Why don't you declare your original sources of plants? Which seed bank? Which gene bank, which country? Columbus did this, pretended he discovered America. Stop, keep pretending you're inventing the seed, and all you do is steal it. But the third aspect of climate smart, in my view, is the part we really need to keep a lookout for. Last year, Monsanto bought up the world's biggest climate data company. And then they bought up the world's biggest soil data company. And what they're really seeking to do is, and they've said it, you know, because I know this was launched in India from ICRISAT, so I've read all the documents. The idea is this: there'll be one agriculture all over the world. They will control every aspect of it. Earlier, they control chemicals, then they control chemicals with the seed through genetic engineering. Now they want to control the seed, the soil, the chemicals, the water, and data and information. And in their minds, they figured it all out, you know. There'll be satellites in the sky, the data will be sold to farmers. Farmer wants to know what's the state of my soil, he'll buy the data off his, her soil, rather than know what their soil is. If the farmer wants to know, will it be a drought? Monsanto will tell them it's a drought. You buy our salt tolerant seeds. And this total control system that they want to evolve as climate smart is actually climate dumb. It's dumb because diversity is the only way you can deal with climate change. Decentralization is the only way you can deal with climate change. So more monocultures, more monopoly, more concentration, more centralization is a disaster. Because there's no way the huge variations in climate, they can keep up with it. The only thing that can keep up with it is nature's intelligence in evolution and adaptation, community intelligence, women's intelligence at work. And we've done a lot of study on women's knowledge on adaptation to climate change. And it's amazing. They will tell you exactly which seed will do good in an area with, in a year with low rainfall. They will tell you which species survive an early winter or when the rainfall is too heavy. And that knowledge really is the alternative to the absence of knowledge, because data is not knowledge. I have called it information obesity.
You practically covered all of my questions, a lot of them. I had some notes also on TTIP, mm-hmm. which is now very topical here, and what civil society or what actions can we take? You've given us a few positive examples of success, which is always encouraging, and there's going to be this conference coming up now in Paris. You also spoke about that. But maybe you could tell us a bit more about civil society activities,
yeah,
activism.
So as I mentioned, you know, my work on seeds really gets connected back to the corporations using the GATT and the Free Trade Agreement to put in laws on ownership of seed, Article 27.3b of the TRIPS Agreement in particular. And we worked to make sure our national systems had protections, had exclusions. TTIP and TPP, TPP is the Trans-Pacific Partnership, TTIP is the Transatlantic Trade and Investment Partnership. They're not partnerships, they shouldn't be called partnerships. Partnerships would mean Europeans sit with American citizens and you say, yeah, this is a priority, let's do trade in this way. These are our important issues. And let's make sure we don't destroy our democracy, our constitutions. These partnerships are really corporate impositions. Otherwise, why would they have to be so secret? They've been agreed to. TPP has been agreed to. And yet they're saying we can't let the people know. If they have to hide, there's something to hide. We have seen leaks of the intellectual property part of TPP. We also have seen what are some of the food and agriculture related parts of TTIP. And the three aspects which they haven't managed to get through in the last 20 years through WTO, they wanted to, but we woke up early enough to block it. The first is total ownership on seeds, on medicines, on information, on knowledge. No exemptions, no exclusions. The second is because Europe has gone a different way on GMO safety, biosafety, food safety than the United States, which is much more under the control of corporations. You know, it was the Greens who organized the first European meeting on deliberate release of GMOs, out of which came the biosafety laws. We're talking about 1989. We're talking about a lot of work that went into it. In 2003, Monsanto used President Bush to sue Europe in WTO to get rid of the bans, to get rid of the moratoriums. And I immediately launched a campaign with movements across the world. It was called the Citizens Campaign for GMO in WTO. And the basic thing was we collected about 330 million signatures and sent it to WTO. Actually gave it. Jose Bove, me, Susan George, gave it in Hong Kong. And said, we're watching you. We're watching you. You do make these decisions in secret. And you make it look like it's US versus Europe. No, it's Monsanto versus the citizens of the world. Because if you rule against the bans and against the decision of citizens to be free of GMOs, you are ruling not just against European citizens, but you're ruling against other citizens who don't want GMOs. The WTO did not dare make a strong ruling of any kind. As you know, there was an attempt to dilute European laws recently, and yet the majority of European countries have exercised their option to have a ban, including Austria. The TTIP on harmonization of safety would basically mean get rid of the European options. US has no law. US has no biosafety law. They work on the assumption of substantial equivalence. Pretend a GMO is like a non-GMO, so you don't have to regulate. If there's nothing different, then what do you have to look for? So don't look, don't see, don't find, and say it's proven safe. But ignorance is not proof of safety. Ignorance is ignorance of harm. And this issue is very big, as you know, Seralini, Arpa Kutsai, scientist after scientist being hounded. The third very important issue, which I think will be the most important aspect for civil society activism and for democracy everywhere, is these investor-state dispute settlement systems, where corporations, as investors, claim the right to sue governments if governments listen to their people and say, we'll keep agriculture GMO-free. No, Monsanto will then have the right to say, sorry, Austria, Germany, France, we'd have made so much money selling GMOs and collecting royalties, and you've stolen it from us. So now you compensate us. It's a very strange logic. It's like me saying, I own all your kidneys. There's huge money in kidney transplants. And when you say, no, I have integrity to my body, I say, no, you're interfering in my trade rights. I'll sue you. You made me lose $1 million each. Now compensate me. That's the level of insanity. And behind it is the idea of corporate personhood, that a corporation is a person with rights. And the movement we have to create, and this is the big movement we have to create, is corporations are pieces of paper where we create legal entities to work in the commercial sphere. But within larger boundaries, ecological limits, social limits, limits of democracy, limits set by our constitutions. And if a corporation treads beyond those boundaries, we have the right to withdraw the permission for their existence. This idea of corporate personhood is being established very fast in the United States. And from there, it is permeating through these free trade agreements. It's a very simple issue. It's getting rid of an ontological illusion. Sorry, Monsanto, you can't exist because I can't pinch you, I can't hug you, you don't get born, you don't die like other people do. You have none of the qualities of a person. People say, do you hate Monsanto? I said, I can't hate Monsanto, it doesn't exist. I love everyone, but I can't even love Monsanto because it doesn't exist as a person. It exists as a legal permission. And we've got to become very foundational in these issues and very creative. And one of the things that has really worked for us in India to deal with this is reclaiming Gandhi's Satyagraha. Satyagraha was the force of truth. Gandhi used it against apartheid in South Africa when they tried to put compulsory badges on race. He used it against the indigo cultivation. He used it against the salt law that the British were imposing on us. Can you imagine in hot countries like India, if salt is a monopoly, how much money they'd have made? Gandhi walked to the beach, picked it up and said, sorry, nature gives it for free, we'll continue to make our salt. And we won't obey your laws. And we will have to find creative ways to bring down this myth that corporations are person. Now, the India-EU agreement is actually stalled right now. And it's stalled over the fact that Europe is imposing, through the pressure of multinational pharmaceutical industry, all kinds of unreasonable criteria on the generic drugs industry of India. We have a big worry because a big part of the European India Free Trade Treaty is free trade in dairy. Now, the big dairy industry of Europe has destroyed the dairy farmers here. They can destroy the Indian farmers. India is the biggest dairy economy of the world. I don't think you realize that. And who produces? One woman with two cows. That's the base. And the world's biggest cooperative is our dairy cooperative, where women take care of the cow, make the milk, it's collected, put into chilling plants, and then into a national grid, distributed all over. So the marketing system is totally national, but the production unit is very small, tiny, decentralized. And that combination has made India very, very strong in the dairy sector. It's a women's sector. And sometime in the future, the groups might want to screen a lovely film called Manthan. Manthan means the churning. You know, when you separate, when you take yogurt and churn to make buttermilk and butter, that action is called Manthan. And there's a brilliant film made on this cooperative, but as a feature film with a beautiful actress who's no more, Smita Patil. And it's very, very inspiring. So the dairy issue is very big, but the generic medicine issue is very big between Europe and India. And as I said, you know, they're overstepping their boundaries so fast that at this point, even the Indian government, which is running along with this free trade agreement, has had to say, you can't do this. We won't negotiate till you stop this undemocratic imposition of crazy norms. It has nothing to do with safety. But they pretend it's about safety. It's like a bit about, you know, a small tomato and a big tomato. A small tomato is declared unsafe. How do they measure safety? Not by looking at the tomato or the pesticide residues. They look at it through a silly tray, which is holes of a certain size. And if the tomato goes through, it's declared unsafe. That is what is phytosanitary measures. Food safety rests on measurement of uniformity rather than the bringing of diversity, which is where resilience comes, but also where freedom comes from diversity.
There's quite a few suggestions on how to continue and continue initiatives that already exist. At this point, maybe we could go into the discussion.
Mm-hmm.
And I would like to ask the audience if there's any questions, statements that someone would like to make. As I had mentioned at the beginning, you can, if you feel uncomfortable with the English, you can ask your question in German, but the answer will be then in English.
Thanks so much for coming out of the first talk. That was amazing. My question has got to do with soil and time. We all know how important the relationship of the bacteria in the soil and the bacteria in the gut is. And still, we destroy so much soil each day in Austria, loses about 20 hectares each day to development. And it seems like there's such a big misconception of the value of ecosystem resiliency. So my question really is, how do you teach people to appreciate timescales on an ecological level?
Well, you know, this year is the year of soil. Yeah? 2015 is the year of soil. And it has actually created a lot more consciousness than there was before 2015 started. There are three contributions we have made. One, I suggest all of you look at the website seedfreedom.info, where we have the manifesto Terra Viva. Terra Viva connects the crisis of soil, the crisis in countries like Syria and Nigeria of desertification, climate change, and the connection to conflicts, as well as what are the paths out of these multiple crises? What are the frameworks of a new economy and new democracy that we must create to avert absolute disaster? And we've basically, it was a very, you know, important group of people. And it turns out that the current system, which, as I said, in soil, not oil, you know, every time capital grows, nature shrinks, it's basically an extractive economy. Not just extractive for oil and extractive from minerals, but extractive of soil fertility, extractive of people's wealth, extractive of the common good, and extracts and concentrates on the top, which is why you get the 1% phenomena happening. And what we need is circular economies. where more circulates between society and the soil, more circulates within society, which is why people get taken care of in certain societies. And in other societies, you have deep polarization. Another contribution has been a film called The Living Soil, which is available on YouTube if you, I don't know how you get to it, but I'm sure there's a way you can find it. And then actually I called people from the food, agriculture, soil movement from around the world, and I undertook a soil pilgrimage from 2nd October, Gandhi's birth anniversary, to 5th of October. And the pilgrimage was to where Gandhi had nourished the freedom movement from, and then where Howard, who was the British scientist who was sent to India to introduce chemicals in 1905, he came and saw the soils were fertile and learned from the peasants how to maintain good soils. He's called the father of modern organic farming. Wrote a book called The Agricultural Testament. And as he says, this is written under my professors, the Indian peasant and the pest. So that soil pilgrimage, there's a pledge, and I think you can find that too. How do we shift the paradigm about soil? First, I think just by having more people care for the soil and celebrate the soil and doing those other economies, the audits I mentioned, other indicators. You know, in India, we have a new government which passed three ordinances to grab all the land of the farmers. It really believes in replacing villages with smart cities. The word smart has become like a disease. So I went into the roots. I said, okay, what does smart really mean? And smart means the thieves, you know? And in German, I think it meant smart. Smarting meant the pain, you know? My elbow smarted when I knocked it. So either it's painful or dishonest. And it's terrible to design society around pain and dishonesty. Then you can design it around wholesomeness and well-being. So what we've done is to block that law. And it's been blocked down. We said, you're treating soil as dead. You're treating the peasant as disposable. But this is what farmers give you. And our calculations are $1.2 trillion annually in environmental benefits. If we add health benefits, it'll be another trillion. You add all the countries, we're talking about $15, $20 trillion of contributions farmers make through the living soil. And now we are organizing cities and farmers. Just tell the citizens, you will only get good food when you have when you're linked to a farmer. And the farmer has fertile soil they can work with. So those are the shifts we will need to make. We have to do the science, but we have also to do the activism. There's nothing like creative activism in waking society up. And society is sleeping just now.
Okay. Yes, we agree.
Thank you. Any other questions? Comments?
Okay, everybody is.
Yes. Yes, I have two questions. First is, what are your hopes of COP21? Is it going to be enough? Or is it going in the wrong direction? Is it just not enough? And the second one is, I've read somewhere about rice fields that are use less water, so that less methane is produced. Is there something going on?
Okay, so on the first issue, you see, when Copenhagen summit started, everything looked good. And then President Obama flew in after his Nobel Prize and sat with China, India, and all the polluters and said, let's subvert this agreement. Let's do voluntary commitments, not legally binding. So what will be the tricks played at COP21? You can't predict. All you can predict is this nonsense of climate smart will be floating around quite a bit. But as I've been saying over the last few months, even if the governments fail in Paris, we can't fail the planet because it is about the human species surviving into the future or making this planet totally uninhabitable for our species. So we can't fail. And as I gave you all those figures on living soil, rich in carbon, organic farming, reducing food miles, the answers are there. We've got used to thinking, here's a big problem, and it needs a big entity to make a big solution. That's where we have to flip to the Gandhi spinning wheel. Here's a very big problem. That's why we have to engage millions and millions of people to shape an alternative that makes this problem, addresses this problem, solves it, and makes the system that is based, that is, has a vested interest in continuing, the system that causes the problem, it makes that irrelevant. Our dealing with giant corporations, especially in the food sector today, can only be through making them irrelevant by our actions, our choices, our commitments. In terms of rice, we save rice. We've saved 4,000 varieties of rice. If you were to come to Navdani, and we offer, of course, every September, October, on the A to Z of agroecology. It's an international course. We also have internships throughout the year at the Earth University, the Beach Vidyapeeth. Any of you, very, very welcome to come. You just have to go to the navdania.org website and look for Earth University. But if you come to our farm, and we're growing, I think there are 750 varieties of rice right now, about 80% don't need irrigation. This idea that rice needs irrigation is born of the chemical agriculture and the Green Revolution. So a lot of rices are what we call rain-fed. They depend on the rain. And so rain-fed rices need absolutely no water. There's no flooding there. But more importantly, even when there is more water in heavy rainfall areas, you don't have to have methane emissions. If you have rice and ducks, and the ducks are paddling, no methane buildup. It's when you have poisons, then the ducks die. And then you have methane. So all of the problems of rice paddies are a result of chemical agriculture, not of rice. Just as much as the problems of climate change are not a problem of the sun, because President Bush had a proposal to put reflectors in the sky to send the sunlight back. And that's what, sun is a blessing, it's not a problem. And there are all of these other geoengineering issues of put pollutants in the sky, make artificial volcanoes, pollute the atmosphere, we'll have global cooling. No, we can have global cooling with good food. Grow good food to have global cooling. Yeah.
You talked a lot about patents, but I recently learned about African farmers rediscovering the pre-colonial crops because they figured out that they're much more resilient to climate change than those brought by the colonial power. So how do you see the colonial legacy in this whole problem?
Well, I think the colonial, I wouldn't honor it with the word legacy. I'm sure there are other phrases that you can create for destructive processes. Because legacies are desirable. They should last. This should never have happened. And I mentioned the Pope, the current Pope, and his Laudato Si. But there was a Pope who passed a papal bull in 1493 after Columbus arrived in America. And then this bull was passed. It was called Intercetra. It was an encyclical about conquering and overthrowing all barbarians. And who was a barbarian? Anyone who was not white and anyone who was not Christian was by definition a barbarian. So all the world outside Europe was defined into barbarianism. And then you could take their land. That was the bull. Go, take the lands on our behalf because I work on behalf of God. And I give power to the king, who then gives power to Columbus and other conquerors. Go grab the land of anyone you can grab. So land grab was very, very much part of colonialism. And the genocide, I mean, if you look at the figures of the Aboriginal people killed, the Native Americans wiped out. We are talking about, I think, the largest genocide the world has seen with the land grab of colonialism. And with it went all the crops, because what? What did the colonizers look for? That which could be globally traded. Cotton as a commodity, grow it in America, grab the land from the Native Americans, plant cotton, take the Africans, capture them as slaves, make them work on it. And you know, when they say the textile industry was efficient, I always add this little equation. I said, tell me how efficient. It wasn't the factories of England. It was all of this colonialism that really made that edifice work, which is why Gandhi's work in bringing it down was so important. So we have a 500-year mistake, a brutal mistake of colonialism. Then we have a 250-year brutal mistake, 200 years of fossil fuel, 250 years of mechanistic thought. Another brutal mistake which has devastated the planet, destroyed societies. We have a 20-year mistake of globalization. We should end all three, because each builds on the other. Without colonialism, you wouldn't have had a Bacon. Without a Bacon and Descartes, you wouldn't have a Monsanto claiming invention of seed as a machine. And as I've written in my book, Biopiracy, I've called it the second coming of Columbus, the patenting. Because, again, you know, when I find a troublesome word, I like to go to its root. Where did it start? Where did the word patent start? So, you know, when you had all these Hungarian, Austrian empire, lots of letters used to be exchanged. But they were closed and sealed letters because they were all about conspiracy. So they put a stamp and no one else could open it. But what Columbus got, what is it, was a letter patent. Patent simply meant open letter, which he could scroll out and announce, the Pope has empowered my king and queen to empower me to grab your land. That was the letter patent. So I call Monsanto today taking a TRIPS agreement, writing it, pushing it on the world, or future TTIP, is like second coming of Columbus. Yeah, I've written a patent law. Now your seeds are mine. I've written a patent law. I can steal what I want to from your society and patent it and make you pay royalties to me. So colonialism is a very big part of the story, very, very big part of the story. And I really feel, for those of you who are students and study, someone compare the Laudato Si and its principles and philosophy to etc. What kind of world are the two creating? I'm so grateful to Pope Francis that he has taken it on himself morally to not continue that tradition.
You mentioned the urban-rural linkages and the urban and farmer linkages. And I just wonder your position on or the demographic development of urbanization and rural depopulation, and how that is problematic, maybe regarding these linkages in huge metropolis and huge cities.
You know, I have a very simple thesis. What humans do, they can undo. Now, if they've created a crazy economic system which measures productivity of agriculture in a very false way, takes highly productive systems that are ecologically sustainable, produce more nutrition. We have a report called Health Per Acre, where we measure the nutrition per acre, and it's much, much more on ecological farms. And then we've done the wealth per acre, which is the true cost accounting. Now, at the true level, small farms are necessary. Small farms feed us. 70% food we eat today comes from small farms. But there's this other manipulated machine which says small farms are inefficient, organic is inefficient, therefore wipe them out. We can undo that. I mean, that's my work. I have a new book actually after all these. It was written for the Milan Expo. It should be out in English soon. It's called Who Really Feeds the World? because the Milan Expo was on feeding the world. And of course, all the corporations were trumpeting around, we feed the world, we feed the world. So the publisher said, can you reply all this? So I wrote a reply. Who really feeds the world? I said, pesticides don't feed the world. The pollinators do. Fertilizers don't feed the world. The soil and microorganisms do. The corporations don't feed the world. Women do. And small farmers do. So given that there is that need for a paradigm shift at every level of every discipline, that's one part. The second is, just because some cities have become big doesn't mean a big city must go 10,000 miles away for its food. I talk about food sheds. You know, we all have thought about watersheds. You don't go 8,000 miles for your local water supply for your municipality. What you do is protect your watershed, keep it safe, don't allow pollutants, and that's how the planning for water is done, through watersheds. We need food sheds. A small town will have a smaller food shed. A big town will have a bigger food shed. But it'll still be local with respect to that urban area. So a big town might have 100 or 200 kilometer food shed. And a small one will have a 5 mile food shed. But it's just that your circle becomes bigger, but it's still a circle. And not these linear exploitation, long distance. Things which are trashing the earth, 75% destruction of all resources. It is trashing the farmers. It's this system that is designed so that farmers can't make it. And it is also exploiting the consumer, both through disease as well as food costs. I've done lots of studies to show that with globalization, you know, normally food prices go like this. This is the price farmers get. This is the price consumers pay. 6%, 10% difference. And with globalization, it starts to go like that. Consumers pay more and more. Farmers get less and less. It's now 1%. 1% of what the consumer pays reaches the farmer. That 99% is what Walmart grows with. That 99% is what Starbucks and Nestle's grow with. That 99% is what allows Pepsi to make money out of potato chips where only 1% is reaching the farmer. I've done these studies with the potato growers. So what we do is close this gap through the circular and circulate more. So this, I've never understood this. Why do people say, oh, big urban areas means you must have 10,000 mile supply chains? No, big urban areas means go from 10 miles to 100. Go to 150 also. It's all right, you know, but there will still be a local. And why do we need to build this? Got to address climate change, this is the only way we will. Got to protect the soil, only way we will. Got to have more work from the land. You use the word depopulation of rural areas. We will have to repopulate rural areas. Otherwise, you'll have more and more unemployment. You'll have more and more refugees. Because if every place is assumed, flush out people from the rural areas, kill the villagers, it's an unlivable future. And it doesn't take too much. I was in a very, very wealthy part of the US. Half the audience like this was young farmers. So I said, how come you can farm in this very rich area? They said the rich area was smart enough to decide that their villages and farmlands would stay farmlands. So they passed a local council meeting and said, no rural farmland will be converted to urban sprawl. And that created a land trust to which young people can turn for employment and meaning. You know, it's not just employment. I mean, I get for training at Abij Vidyapeet, I get people from the software industry who are dying within. They get a fat check from the banks and financial institutions, hedge funds. They're going crazy. They say, I want sanity, I want to farm.
Thank you. The next question?
I have a question on the culture of knowledge.
I see a kind of a problem in the Western tradition of breaking with traditional knowledge in the means of what we believe in, or what legitimization of knowledge nowadays is for us, is scientific approval. And the scientific approval always is cutting with traditions. In terms of other cultures and times, when there was an old book, it only got the legitimization then because it was at least 2,000 years old. So do you believe nowadays we can solve kind of cognitive and everyday problems by getting again a balance of science and tradition, and which kind of science do you see for a modern society again?
Okay, so I wouldn't contrast science and tradition. What I would say is there's pluralism of knowledge, and science only means to know. So science is knowledge. It's only in the mechanistic, reductionist era of the Bacons and the Descartes and the Newtons, you start to define the science of fragmentation and division as a science with a capital S. That only that will count as science. Everyone else's knowledge will count as not science. So women's knowledge goes, ancient knowledge goes. I gave the 100th anniversary lecture for our first Ayurveda college. Ayurveda is the Indian, it means the science of life, it literally means the science of life. And it's the ancient Indian tradition of healing. And everyone today, you know, all the Europeans, all the Americans are descending in Kerala for Ayurvedic treatment because it just works better. Now, 100 years or more than 100 years ago, the British tried to criminalize it and say, you've got to shut this down. But there wasn't a school, there wasn't individual Veds would heal. Veds would teach next generation in their homes, make their own medicines. And the British said, no. So this particular Ved was smart, with Dr. Warrior. He said, we will create institutions like them, but we will maintain our content. So we'll have medical schools, but we'll teach Ayurveda. We'll have pharmacies, but we'll make Ayurvedic medicine. So this Ayurveda Shala then became the place for defense against the British dismembering. The same is needed today for agriculture. But it isn't just that the Baconian system made Western knowledge privileged and turned all of the rest of knowledge into non-knowledge. Today we have a bigger tragedy. And that tragedy is this, that today corporations have taken over research and science. And they're not doing science because for them, inquiry and figuring out how nature works is not the issue. For them, manipulation is the issue. And if nature's working in a different way from what you thought, hiding that is an issue. So someone raised the issue of the soil-gut connection. Well, you know, we have bacteria in our gut. Roundup kills bacteria. But they say it won't affect the human being because our cells don't have the shikimate pathway. But 600 trillion cells, most of them are bacteria in the human body. And Roundup kills the shikimate pathway in the bacteria, leading to all the consequences, including the gut-brain connection. So you just manipulate, you hide. And in fact, in the name of that privileged science, you are creating anti-science. You're creating anti-science. What we are witnessing with Monsanto is an enterprise of anti-science. Whether it is preventing the Americans from knowing what they're eating, the labeling law fight just now, the Dark Act, denial to Americans of the right to know, or it's hounding scientists, I mentioned Seralini, or it's preventing research of certain kinds. All over the place, they have a huge, huge influence. So what is the contemporary role of knowledge and science? I will use the two interchangeably, because I'll use the word science with a small s. Science is to know. Everyone knows. Everyone knows differently. Just like there are artists. Every artist's work isn't the same. Science, too, is a cultural activity. And as a cultural activity, different systems evolve different criteria of testing reliability, authenticity, etc. So the challenge in our times is this. There is, thank goodness, enough independent science for new knowledge to emerge. For example, I mean, I did my quantum theory, but epigenetics, the whole fundamentalism on which genetic engineering is based is genetic determinism. The genes determine everything. Very false. Genes are one aspect of a self-organized organism. And everything has a role. And science is teaching us that. Of course, again, they try and shut down those departments, etc. But it comes out all the time. Gene ecology. All the work we have, you know, in the science of industrial agriculture, the soil was defined as an empty container to hold the nitrogen, phosphorus, potassium. We now know through science, because we can now use microscopes to see the brilliance of diversity in the soil. What we need is a new convergence, not a new standardization, but a new convergence, a new confluence between those ancient systems tested over time and the new ecological systems that are emerging. And both then become the alternative to the anti-science that is being used to justify destruction of human health and the planet. And the seed is a very important area for this. So, for example, not only did we save seeds, we do participatory research. We do participatory breeding. And now we've written a book, a little manifesto called The Law of the Seed, which is absolutely the top experts, you know, the person who is to head FAO's Plant Genetic Resources Commission, Salvatore Ceccarelli, the world's top participatory breeder. We put our minds together and said, what is the true law of the seed? What does the seed tell us, and what does breeding from women tell us? That you breed for diversity, you breed for resilience, you breed for nourishment. What are the standards of the industrial breeding? Uniformity, uniformity, uniformity. This was what was being used 2 years ago to bulldoze a seed law on Europe, which was defeated because of a very broad alliance, including the seed freedom movement and your own Arkenoa, the seed savers of Austria. So in every, I think it's in health, it's in agriculture, it's in food. I would even say if people have the guts, it's also in mental health, because what's going on with mental health is crazy. They are literally making, you know, it's normal for people who are under pressure to feel the pressure. And you define it in all kinds of ways and turn it into a psychiatric problem. Monsanto has defined the search for organic as a new psychiatric problem. I can't remember the name, but they have a name for those who look for healthy food. It's a psychiatric problem.
Now we really have to get armed to fight this. There's two more questions, and then we'll start closing up.
I don't have a question.
Or a comment, yes?
Thank you so much for inspiring me and us. I just want to say to you all here, we have a competition for soil protecting. And if you are interested to see this competition, go on Stadtfrucht. And there you can see the link to sign this petition if you want. That's quite huge areas of Vienna stay alive as agriculture areas.
What's the name of the website again?
Stadtfrucht.
Stadtfrucht. Okay, thank you. Very interesting to know about this. I hadn't heard yet. Yes?
I would like to hear a little bit more about this circular society that you said would be the opposite of the extractive economy. Do you have in mind like the big economies of the Adivasi in India, or what is exactly this opposite of
okay.
the extractive economy?
So when we're talking of extractive systems, linear extractive system, and circular systems, we're of course talking of the economy, but we're also talking about politics. Because what are free trade treaties but taking power out of communities, nations, and putting them in the hands of invisible corporations who make all the decisions. That's a linear extraction of power from people. So what the circular economy, a very good example, is what I was describing, a circular relationship with the soil. The soil, you plant a seed, you plant seeds carefully to maximize photosynthesis and biomass. You get more organic matter, you return a large part to the soil, you eat a bit. And as you do that, you build up more and more and more soil fertility and more organic carbon. That is a circular economy of agriculture. And because of the linear extractive system, it only measures the throughput, yeah? What are the commodities you extracted from the farm? So we have more and more commodities, but we have less and less food. 90% of the corn and soya, which is the largest acreage that is spreading, because it's connected to intellectual property, 90% of the corn and soya goes for biofuel and animal feed. That's not a circular economy, it's a linear extractive economy. You talked about Adivasis, yes. Wherever there are commons, wherever there's mutual gift, and all societies that were circular are gift economies. So the gift and the commons rather than commodities and grabbing. But it isn't just Adivasi societies, which are the indigenous societies. This is the kind of economies we have to build now, as more and more young people are thrown into a non-option for their future. I work with Greeks, I work with Italian youth, I work with Spanish youth. I worked with the government of Rome, and they said to me, you know, we love your work on seed, but our big problem is youth unemployment. I said, let your youth that are unemployed have gardens. Give them land. All you need to do is give land. They will do the rest. That's a circular economy. So a circular economy isn't of the past. It is the basis of a future. Circular economy in terms of giving with gratitude back to the earth, and circular in terms of relating together as community.
Thank you.
I would like to thank everybody for coming, and I would like to thank Vandana Shiva, especially. She came straight from the airport to us. So, and we had a really powerful talk. I'm very happy that you were here. And now we know that the future is, we're going to solve everything with farming. We can apply it to almost everything now. Yes, I'm taking that with me. I apologize again for the crowded situation, but next time we'll know. We need at least 3 times as large a room. Thank you on behalf of all the other organizations for coming, and good evening.
Thank you.